coming up an episode that is sure to be panned, as in water pan, and Kingsford's got a new product we'll take a look at.
Fire it up.
Of American barbecue, it is Jack Waiboer, Bill West. Great TV time, and you know what? A little cooler. I'm still trying to do the shorts, but
springtime is coming in Mount Pleasant, South Carolina. It is not a beautiful day, but it is tolerable out here. Spring is coming. The flowers are popping all around us, and of course, that always means the pollen is out too, Bill.
It is. Yeah. It's been getting some people. We're getting letters at GrateTV.com, either Jack at GrateTV.com or Bill at GrateTV.com. And one of them comes from Kyle. I guess it's Kyle. It's not Kyle Fitzgerald. Yeah, it is Kyle Fitzgerald out in Montgomery, Texas. He writes, Jack and Bill, love the podcast. Keep up the great work. I was reading Smoking with Myron Mix, and he talks about why he uses a water pan in the smoker. He says it creates a water bath system inside the smoker and helps maintain the meat's moisture content, which is found naturally in the fat. He goes on to say it tenderizes the meat while you're cooking. So his question is, what are your thoughts on a smoker with a water pan versus one without? Does it really help the meat so it won't dry out? Thanks, Kyle Fitzgerald, Montgomery, Texas. So does a water pan and the water inside the pan really matter? I think the biggest thing with like these smokers here is it's not dripping onto the coals. It's not flaming
That's
up.
Right.
It's a consistent indirect heat. But is the water in the actual pan something that makes a difference?
It all depends on the style of cooker that you're using. A lot of cookers are very... Oh, beer.
Yeah.
We'll cheers. Do a cheers first, and then we'll answer questions.
Mm-hmm. Or beer in the water
That's
pan.
Good. Beer in a water pan isn't a bad idea. Moisture is really what it's all about. Once again, it's all a matter of what kind of cooker that you're using and the convection involved in the unit and a lot of different variables that go on whether the water pan will do you well or not. In an offset cooker, the heat is usually a dry heat source, and it's usually convecting through the tube at a pretty good rate. So really what a water pan does is kind of keeps the spikes down and kind of evens out the heat within the chamber itself, and it adds moisture to the environment. But you got to watch how much moisture is actually in that environment, because you don't want it to be dripping on the meat and kind of condensing as it you know, it vaporizes mm-hmm. coming out, and then it kind of condenses, and that creates just a nasty little creosote kind of flavor on your meat. And that's not really what you want to have going on.
I don't think I've had that before, and I usually use on the Brinkman either the electric or the
sure.
charcoal. I'll fill that pan up with water.
And there's certainly, it's a good system, and the water kind of, The heat comes around that water pan and kind of comes up around the top. And as it comes up around the top and rolls up around that lid and comes back down on the meat again, if that heat is a little bit moister, it does help the meat retain moisture, because moisture is naturally coming out of the meat and going to the environment. We know that.
Mm-hmm.
So if the moisture is in there, it kind of tempers that heat, that pull the meat out of the moisture to make the environment more moist. So it does help kind of retard that. But does it actually tenderize meat? I really can't buy that one. The tenderizing process is done through the slow process of breaking down the connective tissue and finding that balance within your cooker where the moisture is staying in and not radiating out as hard and as fast. The guys who use the water baths the most are the guys who are cooking hot and fast, and they need that water in there to keep that outer crust of the meat moist.
I was going to say, I mean, if you're cooking low and slow, I never have a problem with the bark getting too dry.
Right.
So that doesn't really affect the water bath. Doesn't really affect that to me.
It doesn't affect the moisture content of the meat. However, a good balance of moisture within the cooking environment itself, especially because the heat is naturally drying things out all around, is always a good thing to have. And it does kind of help to even out the spikes and to keep that reaction from happening too fast so the outside of the meat burns up. That's really what moisture is good for. A lot of the cookers, like the double insulated Bill, are moist on their own. The moisture, they're so tight and they're so well insulated, and the heating process is so good that you really don't even need to introduce moisture into those environments, because the meat itself is actually moisturizing the internal environment.
So then you don't, yeah.
You really wouldn't need to do it.
I think these bullet cookers are made for it. And
yeah, I like to use them in my bullets. I do like to put a water pan in my offset, but I don't like to put it in my offset with large cuts. I'll put it in for ribs or for chicken because it'll keep that moisture, it'll keep that environment a little moisture. But on the long cuts like Boston butts and brisket, I'm actually looking to use my heat correctly and get my convection balance down so that I'm creating the bark that I want to create on both of the long cooks.
Thanks for the email.
That's pretty cool right there.
We get some other ones too. Sean Duke sent us a little another picture, and he's getting us a bunch of them. Two chickens smoked with blackjack oak from Waycross, Georgia.
That's awesome. Look at that picture right there. That is Waycross, Georgia is a place we'd like to go. You know, we compete in Waycross, Georgia a lot.
I got the wood from my brother on a visit home for Thanksgiving. It turned out real good in the UDS. He loves Great TV, and he sent us a bunch of pictures.
Yeah, UDS is the ugly drum smoker, and of course, you know, you can't beat blackjack oak, especially in the Southeast. It's a very prevalent wood for cooking around here.
This is my next one is one of my favorite pictures we've got in a long time. It's the bacon burger dog. Steve Kane, we need to try this just as a...
It looks like an awesome piece.
It's it's like the poor man's, turducken.
Turducken.
Hot dog, hamburger, wrapped in bacon.
Bacon and baked. What?
Bacon burger dog, as my son calls it, the carnivore Twinkie, coming from Steve Kane. Thanks,
try that one. That looks pretty darn good.
I like that very much. All right, send us your great plates. We love getting those.
We do.
And they're more easier than ever to get. I mean, even if it's a restaurant barbecue picture, you can just take the picture and a lot of the iPhone. I mean, if you got an iPhone,
yeah, you're going right to us.
Email it to us, Bill or Jack at GrateTV.com.
We'd love to see it.
Let's get to this little gadget.
The gadget for this week?
Oh, look at this.
This is the grill surface thermometer that we found in a grocery store made by Kingsford.
They always make, this is in a bargain bin. That's why I like it.
In a bargain bin?
Because I probably need another thermometer, but this is one I thought, you know, I could use that.
You know, all the temperatures that we do when we do barbecue, all the processes that we use and everything we go through is all based on surface grate temperature. And this is a perfect little gizmo right here to give you surface of the grate temperature. All you do is throw that little gizmo right down there on top of the grill grate, and it takes the temperature at grate level. And that's a wonderful thing to have. The only thing I would be worried about is that the heat coming up from the heat sink coming onto the grate may give you a little bit of a off read. In other words, the grate is usually hotter than the environment around it. That's why I would recommend that maybe you put a little something underneath that to kind of prop it up. And I don't know if these things bend down or not.
Actually, the reason for those little tabs are so you can pick them up with a tong.
Look at that. Comes right out of there. So check this out. If you turn it around.
So you'd recommend.
You could put it on the grate like that, and the heat would be going up underneath it. It wouldn't actually be taking the temperature of the grill grate, but taking the temperature of the environment around the grill grate.
Okay.
That's very cool, right?
It would still work if you want to pull it off the
Look at that.
The grill grate. Because I think that's all that is, so you don't looks like.
Yeah, you put your little fork in there or your meat fork or whatever and lift it up off of there or pick it up with your spatula. Certainly, safety-wise, you don't want to be reaching your hands down in there and picking that thing up off a hot grill. That would be a grill foul.
They also say don't put it on there when you're heating it up because it'll
preheat.
Condensation.
Condensation. Read the directions. Make sure you don't fog it up. And quite frankly, you don't want to ruin it because it's probably worth $5 or something.
Our secret ingredient this week. I just wanted something different, maybe a vegetable. Carrots.
Carrots. Look at that.
And when I went to talk about carrots and to get some in the store. I wanted to talk about how you could get carrots.
Right.
The one way, a little trick or a tip to get carrots that are more fresh would be get the ones instead of the bags of
regular carrots, yeah.
Yeah. Get the ones with the green stalks on them, old-fashioned way.
Right.
So you know you've got a gauge on whether they're really fresh or not. Well, the guy's like, yeah, those end up sitting there and they rot, so we don't keep them in stock anymore.
Really? But we need to go back to the old way of choosing carrots, because I tell you, if you choose
farmer's
carrots
market,
greens,
you're going to get fresh ones,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, you should. And you look at those greens and make sure that, you know, they're good and they're not, browning and getting, stale, I guess, dying on the shelf. You certainly want to pick better carrots.
But I also did think this is cool, too. Now you can get it microwave in bag.
Microwave in bag. And I'll tell you what, fingerling carrots just like that, a little olive oil, a little salt and pepper, throw them right on the grill. Makes a real nice side. You get them on the grill about 10 or 15 minutes and they'll solid right up. And we all know that carrots are good for us. Provides beta carotene, good for your eyes, good health food, good snack stick. A lot of good things come out of a carrot, so we want to go ahead
carrot
and...
Carrot salad?
Carrot salad, carrot slaw.
Is that the same thing?
I guess. Carrots in the coleslaw, a whole lot of ways to look at it, and certainly carrots are good for you. Ask Bugs Bunny.
That's it. We're going to have a little snack here, and we'll be back in about a week. Send us your great plates, greattv.com. Like us on Facebook, and please share us on Facebook, too.
Carrots are kind of sweet, too. I really like that. Might be used as a sweetener somewhere along the way.
Good stuff.
You know, you could puree it up. Anyway, you know, it's a crazy world we live in, guys. Buy local, think global, stay sustainable. And I can tell you this, every chance you get, hug your mother.